Blessed be our God forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we pray you graciously to behold this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given unto the hands of sinners and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
The service is nominally in your prayer book, but I'm using the Episcopal prayer book because it follows the same pattern, but it has a little more stuff in it. So we have three lessons: the Old Testament, the Psalm, the Epistle, and the Gospel. And instead of a sermon, I'll say a few words after each reading. Then we end with it. Then we have the Collects, which is much like the prayers of the people, and but a little longer, of course. And then another prayer, and then finishing with the Lord's Prayer and a final collect. So the readings. The first reading is from the book of Isaiah, a long reading, chapter 52, 4th Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up, and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of mortals. So he shall startle many nations. Kings will shut their mouth because of him. For that which has not been told, they shall see, and that which they had not heard, they shall contemplate. Who believed what we have heard, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For he grew up before him like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity. As one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases, yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. Like all sheep, we have gone astray. We have turned to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so it did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? For he was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, although he had done no violence and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring and shall prolong his days. Through him will the will of the Lord will prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will allot him a portion of the great, and he shall divide the spoils with the strong. Because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors, yet he bore the sins of many and made intercessions for the transgressors. The word of the Lord. In this reading from Isaiah, we can hear the ideas that Christianity has brought together about why Jesus died, about how he suffered, not only because of what he said, which was true and which was right, but how he threatened the institutions of the day, how it then seems to transform him into the model of the scapegoat, the one who is sacrificed for our sins, the one who has been crucified and died because of what we have done or not done. And you could see that in the New Testament theology and how it weaves in and out of those two kinds of things, the righteous suffering servant and suffering in the place, as we see it in Christianity, in the place of the sacramental system of the temple of Judaism. So we think on those things on Good Friday. What's good about it? How does it affect you? What kind of feelings do you have about coming? And I know there's lots of feelings about by people who won't come on Good Friday because it's too grim. And of course, the Passion narrative, which we're going to get again today in our gospel, and the Crown of Thorns, which we bring out once a year. It's been in the church here for 3 years now, this particular plant, and little drops of blood, as you can see, blooming on it. The way Christ was crucified, with thorns, with criminals, out of town, out of the walls, onto the hill of the skull. The psalm is Psalm. Oh, not yet. No, the psalm is Psalm 22, which fits in right well with the crucifixion. But usually we don't hear the whole psalm. My God, why have you forsaken me and are so far from my cry and from the words of my distress? Oh my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not answer. By night as well, but I find no rest. Yet you are the Holy One, enthroned upon the praises of Israel. Our forefathers put their trust in you. They trusted, and you delivered them. They cried out to you and were delivered. They trusted in you and were not put to shame. But as for me, I am a worm and no man, scorned by all and despised by the people. All who see me laugh me to scorn. They curl their lips and wag their heads, saying, "He trusted in the Lord. Let him deliver him. Let him rescue him if he delights in him." Yet you are he who took me out of the womb, kept me safe upon my mother's breast. I have been entrusted to you ever since I was born. You were my God when I was still in my mother's womb. Be not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is none to help. Many young bulls encircle me, strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their jaws at me like a ravening like a roaring lion. I am poured out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart within my breast is melting wax. My mouth is dried out like potsherd. My tongue sticks to the roof of my mouth. and you have laid me in the dust of a grave. Packs of dogs close me in, and gangs of evildoers encircle me. They pierce my hands and my feet and count all of my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my garments among them. They cast lots for my clothing. Be not far away, O Lord, for you are my strength. Hasten to help me. Save me from the sword, my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the lion's mouth, my wretched body from the horns of wild bulls. I will declare your name to my brethren in the midst of the congregation. I will praise you. Praise the Lord, you that fear him. Stand in awe of him, O offspring of Israel, all you of Jacob's line, give glory. For he does not despise or abhor the poor in their poverty, neither does he hide his face from them. But when they cry to him, he hears them. My praise is of him in the great assembly. I will perform my vows in the presence of those who worship him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied, and those who seek the Lord shall praise him. May your heart live forever. All the ends of the earth remember and turn to the Lord. All the families of the nations shall bow before him. For kingship belongs to the Lord. He rules over nations. To him alone all who sleep in the earth bow down in worship. All who go down to the dust fall before him. My soul shall live for him. My descendants shall serve him. They shall be known as the Lord's forever. They shall come and make known to a people yet unborn the saving deeds that he has done. Well, there's lots of things in that psalm that we are familiar with, especially from the whole idea of the passion narrative of this last, which we'll get in the gospel, which we had last week, yesterday, I guess, for those that might have come to the Maundy Thursday service. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? It's a cry all of us have probably said from time to time, and will probably say again and again. When we feel alone, when we feel that things are too heavy for us, when we feel that the whole world is crushing down upon us, and that God has deserted us. And yet the psalm goes on to say that even though all of this trouble befalls us, or befalls this suffering servant, or our Lord, yet we remain faithful. Faith abides within us and will come out again, hopefully, in time, in the time of trouble, in the time of need, and bring us through our tribulation, through our sorrow, and through the terrible things that happen in our world. Bring us through it, even though we die. Bring us through it, even though it's the end. It's not the end of everything. It's not the end. Even in this psalm, we can hear hints of eternal life, hints of resurrection. And we see also images of the Lord as king, the king over nations, one whom everybody will come to eventually. We wait. We've waited a long time. The psalmist has waited even longer. And yet we hold the faith. We don't understand why the millennium hasn't come, why God hasn't interceded, why he hasn't come to us. And maybe there's more to it than that. Maybe it's through this suffering that we really find out who we are, who our neighbors are, who our friends are, and who our enemies are. Find out how we can get through, and who can help, how we can get through, and how we can help each other, how we can help each other in their troubles and in our own.
Second reading is from Hebrews chapter 10, verses 16 to 25. This is a reading from Hebrews. "This is the covenant that I shall make with them after those days, said the Lord. I will put my laws in their hearts, and I will write them on their minds." He also adds, "I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with a true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for he who has promised is faithful. Let us consider now to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another. And all the more as you see the day approaching." This is the word of the Lord.
Now we have a song to sing, hymn number 803. And you can stand if you'd like. This is kind of a long singing session. Be seated, for the gospel is pretty long, but I'll have you ask you to stand right toward the end of it when we reach Golgotha. The Passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to St. John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." And he replied, "I am he." Actually, the words are ego eimi, I am the one, I am who I am. The name that God had used to Moses when Moses asked who he was. I am he. Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them, and when Jesus said to him, I am he, they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, whom are you looking for? And they said, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus answered, I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go. This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken. I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me. Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's slave and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, put your sword back into the sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me? So the soldiers, their officers, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. And Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priests, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter was standing outside the gate. So the other disciple, whom was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who had guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, are you not one of this man's disciples? And he said, I am not. Now the slave and the priest had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. Jesus answered, I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in the synagogues and in the temple where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said. Then, and when he said this, one of the priests standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying, is that how you answer the high priest? Jesus answered, if I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me? Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, are you not also one of his disciples? And he denied it and said, I am not. One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, did I not see you in the garden with him? Again, Peter denied it. And at that moment, the cock crowed. They took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters, so to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, what accusation do you bring against this man? They answered, if this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you. Pilate said to them, take him yourself and judge him according to your law. The Jews replied, we are not permitted to put anyone to death. This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus and asked him, are you the king of the Jews? Jesus answered, do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me? Pilate replied, I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done? Jesus answered, my kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to you, to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here. Pilate asked, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" After he said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, "I find no cause against him. But you have a custom that I release someone to you at the Passover. Did you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" They shouted in reply, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now, Barabbas was a bandit. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. And the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head. They dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him and saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him." So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." Then the chief priests and the police, the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourself and crucify him. I find no case against him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has claimed to be the Son of God." Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you know I have the power to release you and the power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release him. But the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside, sat on the judge's bench at a place called the stone pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, "Here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed them over to them to be crucified. That was a good time to stand up. So they took Jesus and carried the cross, and he carried the cross by himself. He went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew means Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write, 'The King of the Jews,' but 'This man said, I am King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." Then when the soldiers crucified him, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." And then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop, and they held it to his mouth. And when Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because the Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. And when the soldiers came to break the legs of the first and then the other who had been crucified with him, but when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled, "None of his bones shall be broken." And again, another passage of scripture says, "They will look on the one whom they have pierced." After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission. So he came and removed the body. Nicodemus, who had first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. There was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb which had no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. The Gospel of our Lord. Dear people of God, our Heavenly Father sent his Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved, that all who believe in him might be delivered from the power of sin and death and become heirs with him of everlasting life. We pray therefore people everywhere according to their needs. Let us pray for the Holy Catholic Church of Christ throughout the world, for its unity in witness and service, for all bishops and other ministers and the people whom they serve, for our bishop and all the people of this diocese, for all Christians in this community, and for those about to be baptized, that God will confirm his church in faith, increase it in love, and preserve it in peace. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of our faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray for all nations and peoples of the earth and for those in authority among them, for the President of the United States, for the Congress and the Supreme Court, for members and representatives of the United Nations, for all who serve the common good, that by God's help they may seek justice and truth and live in peace and accord. Almighty God, kindle, we pray, in every heart the true love of peace, and guide with your wisdom those who take counsel for the nations of the earth, that in tranquility of your dominion they may increase until the earth is filled with the knowledge of your love, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for all who suffer and are afflicted in body or in mind, for the hungry and homeless, the destitute and the oppressed, for the sick, the wounded, and the crippled, for those in loneliness, fear, and anguish, for those who face temptation, doubt, and despair, for the sorrowful and bereaved, for prisoners and captives, and those in mortal danger, that God in his mercy will comfort and relieve them and grant them the knowledge of his love. Stir in us the will and patience to minister to their needs. Gracious God, the comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer, let the cry of those in misery and need come to you, that they may find your mercy present with them in all their afflictions. And give us, we pray, the strength to serve them for the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let us pray for all who have not received the gospel of Christ, for those who have never heard the word of salvation, for those who have lost their faith, for those hardened by sin and indifference, for the contemptuous and the scornful, for those who are enemies of the cross of Christ and persecutors of his disciples, for those who in the name of Christ have persecuted others, that God will open their hearts to the truth and lead them to faith and obedience. Merciful God, creator of all peoples of the earth and lover of souls, have compassion on those who do not know you as you are revealed in your Son, Jesus Christ. Let your gospel be preached with grace and power to those who have not heard it. Turn the hearts of those who resist it, and bring home to your fold those who have gone astray, that there may be one flock under one shepherd, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us commit ourselves to our God and pray for the grace of a holy life, that with all who have departed this world and have died in the peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to God alone, we may be accounted worthy to enter into the fullness of the joy of our Lord and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection. O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, look favorably upon your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things that have grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Now let us sing together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power, and power, and glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated while we have a little musical reflection.